The process of developing a drug is as incredible as it is difficult. Every day, we face internal and external threats that endanger our well-being. These constant interactions remind us of the resiliency of the human body, its complexity, interconnectedness, and ability to protect itself. It's what enables your body to recover from a cold, form a scab, or mend a broken bone. But the body's resiliency also makes it difficult to treat a disease that your body can't fight on its own, such as asthma or Alzheimer's. Since your body is accustomed to fighting off these external threats, the same internal reaction will be sparked when you take a drug. Your body will only recognize a foreign substance in your system and will try to fight it off. Beyond this, the drug must also be capable of finding the path it needs to follow to get to the part of your body that needs to be treated. Perhaps it's not surprising to learn that only 1 in 10,000 potential drugs will make it to the shelves of your pharmacy. Think of the process like this. There are thousands of doors in the human body, each with a lock requiring keys to open them. Imagine trying to find a specific key for a specific lock, but both are lost in a sea of locks and keys. When unlocked, these doors can unleash thousands of different responses in the patient. Positive responses, negative responses, sometimes no response at all. Our goal in developing a drug is to find the right key for the right door that provokes the response we want, a treatment. Two of the many issues encountered during this process are, one, these doors can be hard to identify, and two, these keys often open more than one door. So, while the key may open the door that provides a treatment, it may also open a door that provokes a negative effect, such as fever, rash, headaches, or even death. Over time, we learn more about these different doors and keys, and can refine a key to ensure it's only opening the doors we want. It's almost as if we've been given the master key to an apartment building and want to modify it so it will only open one specific door. If we think we have our modified key, tests are performed to ensure the doors we don't want to open stay shut when the key is introduced. If all goes well, the key will then be delivered to patients. It's important that we can recreate the key as many times as necessary without any variation to ensure patients are getting the key that is safe and effective. Of course, we aren't talking about real physical doors or keys. We're using this metaphor to describe the process in which a drug is developed. A patient might just be annoyed with seasonal allergies, or they might be fighting for their life in a battle against cancer. Either way, they're all searching for a way to get better. How does this go from being a patient's dream to their reality? The drug development process is long, tedious, and complex. To simplify this, we've broken it down into the following four steps: find, verify, confirm, and deliver. The first step in creating a treatment is to find out more about the disease and the processes it targets. What part of the body is being attacked? Is it the liver, the heart, or maybe the blood? And what can we use to develop a treatment? Which molecule? What protein? Researchers work to find out where the issue is, what is causing it, and how to disrupt or work around the diseased pathway in your body. Think of these pathways like a giant skyscraper with numerous floors and rooms, all interconnected by hallways, stairwells, and elevator shafts. Only one path to a specific door is affected, while the other pathways should be left alone. In this lock and key metaphor, whatever molecule is used to interfere with the disease pathway is the key, while the actual interference itself is the door opening, disrupting that disease pathway and resulting in a treatment. One of our main goals during this stage is to find a molecule or key that will specifically open the right door along the diseased pathway without opening others. This is known as selectivity. Another one of our goals is to limit the amount of foreign substances we're putting in the body. Therefore, molecules that require a smaller quantity to create that interference are better. This is known as potency. So we start by testing tens of thousands of molecules to see if they have the ability to interfere with the diseased pathway. The number of molecules that show potential is then further reduced based on selectivity and potency. The most promising molecules are then modified in the lab to make them even more effective than they already were. To summarize the find stage, the goal is to identify a molecule that is effective at treating a disease pathway while keeping potency and selectivity in mind. Successfully making it through this stage allows the promising molecule, now known as our drug candidate, to move forward in the process and be verified to ensure it is safe to be given to humans, the part of the process we are referring to as the verification stage. It would be incredibly dangerous to give these drug candidates to sick patients without testing them in a similar living system first. Therefore, before testing any molecule on humans, by law, researchers first need to prove that it is safe in animals. These animals, known as research models, are essential in drug development because their reaction to a molecule is usually predictive of how humans will react to that same molecule. These models have a genetic makeup that is incredibly similar to that of humans, up to 99% depending on the species. This relationship makes animal models absolutely necessary. Drug developers must abide by strict regulations determined by government organizations, which require them to treat animals with the utmost respect and care. They are also committed to the three R's of animal research: refining the methods used that may cause models distress, reducing the number of models needed, and replacing models with alternative processes wherever possible. Although we found a promising drug candidate, there are many things we still don't know. How will the molecule affect the body? How will the body affect the molecule? When will it become toxic? How much can be given to a patient before it becomes dangerous? Studying how the molecule affects the body includes not only making sure it is safe to take, but also discovering how much of the molecule we need in order for it to be effective. One of our main concerns will be assuring that a potential drug can be successful in disrupting the disease pathway long before it becomes dangerous. To figure this out, researchers determine how much of a drug is needed to maximize its benefits and compare it to the amount at which the drug starts to become dangerous. These quantities are referred to as doses, and the further apart these two reference points are, the safer. Researchers also need to understand how the body will affect the drug. This information will help them figure out how the drug should be taken. Will it be a pill, a shot, a nasal spray? How often should it be taken? How long will it stay in your system? We've all seen the directions on an aspirin bottle: take 2 pills every 4 hours. This is what we want to determine. The method in which the drug is taken not only affects how quickly the drug starts working, but also how quickly the body can metabolize and eliminate it from its system. For example, a shot allows the drug to be injected directly into the bloodstream, which will be absorbed more quickly than if a patient took a pill. Researchers must find a balance between how quickly the body gets rid of the drug and therefore how often it will need to be taken. Researchers also need to ensure that a drug candidate won't have long-term toxic effects. Drugs that open unintended doors can potentially cause cancer, gene mutations, reproductive harm, or neurological harm to patients. If researchers can't prevent these toxic effects, they must stop the process and revisit earlier steps. Developing a drug is in no way a smooth or linear process. More often than not, researchers will go back and forth between steps several times due to new findings. To summarize the verify stage, researchers are focused on how effective and safe a drug is in order to prepare it for testing in humans. They do this testing in animal research models because their genetic makeup and biological systems are surprisingly similar to humans. They not only look at both how the drug affects the body and how the body affects the drug, but also the dose levels at which a drug candidate becomes toxic and unsafe. The data collected in this stage will be critical when seeking government approval later on. When researchers have successfully completed this stage and have promising results, they seek approval to move on to what we are calling the confirmation stage and begin administering the drug to humans through a clinical trial. Prior to getting this approval, there are significant financial and ethical considerations to review. The social value and benefit must outweigh the risks to not only the individuals partaking in the study, but also to society as a whole. Therefore, getting approval to enter the confirm stage is a huge milestone. Once a drug is given the green light for a clinical trial, it's broken up into 4 phases with the intention of strategically testing for the safety and effectiveness of the drug in a way that minimizes risks. Phase 1 is comprised of 20 to 80 healthy individuals who are given the drug in order to test for side effects only. In circumstances where the drug is meant to help the critically or terminally ill, the participants may actually be patients. Phase 2 is broken up into two parts and includes roughly 50 to 500 people who do have the disease we're looking to treat. The first part of Phase 2 looks to see if the drug does what it was intended to do. Does it interfere with the disease pathway? While the process thus far has been long, and we've collected a lot of data, this is generally the first time researchers will see whether or not the drug works in a human with the disease. If it does, the second part is to look at dosing more closely. Researchers begin thinking about what form the drug should take and how much of it should be prescribed. Only 20 to 30% of drugs will make it through Phase 2 of the clinical trial and proceed to further testing. Phase 3 is the pivotal point in clinical trials and is essentially an extension of Phase 2. It can involve up to several thousands of people and will show if the drug being developed is a superior product than what is currently on the market. This large population spans across multiple geographic locations and therefore includes people from different backgrounds, ethnicities, and environments. These factors could cause patients to react to the drug in different ways and may reveal rare side effects. By doing this, researchers can account for these variables in their study. Phase 4 looks at the drug after it has been approved by government agencies to be marketed and prescribed. This phase is meant to see what happens once it is in the real world, which is an uncontrolled environment. Once a drug is being mass manufactured for pharmacies, it is important to ensure the drug is still as effective and safe as originally thought. To summarize, the confirm stage is the first time the experimental drug is given to humans. This is done through a clinical trial, which is split into four different phases. Phase 1 only tests the drug to see if it is safe in humans. Phase 2 tests whether the drug is effective and continues to be safe. Phase 3 tests how effective the drug is and how it compares to existing treatments on the market. And finally, Phase 4 monitors how safe and effective the drug is in an uncontrolled environment. The final stage of the drug development process is deliver. We'll have to take a bit of a step back to explain how researchers manufacture their successful drug for both market and for the last two phases of the clinical trial to take place. In the deliver stage, successful results and the supporting data are crucial in whether the drug will be approved to go to market or not. To avoid skewed data and harming patients, manufacturers must give the exact same drug to every participant in the clinical trial. To ensure the drug is the same, manufacturers abide by mandatory precautions set by the government to ensure consistency, a base level of safety, and provide a framework for quality control when drugs are being mass manufactured. The drug starts being mass manufactured for the third phase of the clinical trial and continues to be for the fourth phase, which is where we see the overlap between the confirm and deliver stages. Drugs can be manufactured in one of two ways. You commonly hear about pharmaceutical and biopharmaceutical companies. The difference between them is that pharmaceutical companies produce small molecule drugs, and biopharmaceutical companies produce large molecule drugs. Where the molecule is found determines the size, and therefore, the manufacturing process. Creating a small molecule drug is very similar to following a recipe. All of the materials needed to create the drug are gathered and combined in a large piece of equipment, comparable to a mixing bowl. Different materials are added throughout the production process at varying temperatures and pressures. Once the recipe is finished, as many impurities as possible are removed from the product. Creating a large molecule drug is like growing something. Scientists find and modify cells that can produce a specific protein, which will be the main ingredient. Once they have created a few of these cells, they allow them to grow and multiply from a few to thousands or even millions. Once the cells have multiplied, the researchers need to filter the protein out of the mixture to make the drug. Once we have the main ingredients for both the small and large molecule drugs, they need to be prepared for use in humans. Manufacturers may add approved ingredients that make the drug taste better, last longer in the body, and preserve them for a longer shelf life. The drugs aren't useful if they are difficult for people to take or go bad before reaching the patient. Finally, all the hard work pays off, as patients in need can access the drug in pharmacies all over the world and finally get the treatment they've been dreaming about. This process is far from easy, and we hope you can now see why. There have been some incredible breakthroughs in drug development, and there will continue to be with the hard work and determination of the thousands of people involved, including you.